Major funding for Charlie Rose is provided by DuPont, originator of products and ideas that make a difference in everyday life. DuPont, better things for better living. And by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and the annual financial support of viewers like you. Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
Welcome to the broadcast. Tonight, the conversation with Bob Costas about the end of this baseball season and perhaps other seasons. Dr. Leonard Hayflick, he's the author of a book on aging, and author Fatima Mernissi, she's the author of Dreams of Trespass. We begin with Bob Costas and baseball. They played baseball during the Great Depression. They played it through two world wars. They played it despite the earthquake of 1989. But this year, Acting Commissioner Bud Selig announced today will be the first since 1904 that there will be no World Series. The players and the owners have made little progress during the 34-day strike, and many fear that this work stoppage may last well into next season. Bob Costas, the voice of baseball on NBC Sports, joins me now to put all of this in context. Welcome.
Can that be done?
Can it be done? Tell me how historic this moment is, the canceling of a season, and perhaps something that will extend into 1995. How historic and how damaging to baseball?
Well, in point of bare fact, the last time it happened was 1904, and the first World Series was 1903. Then the next year, the New York Giants refused to play the World Series because of some personal spat with Ban Johnson, who ran the upstart American League.
It was Johnny McGraw, was it, the great manager?
Exactly. Right. So 90 years since the last time a World Series wasn't played. It's never happened before, really, in modern history. In terms of the damage it'll do, this is the sport that depends most on history and continuity. Now, it's not just that you don't have the World Series. If you don't have some resolution to the season, even 1981, which had a 50-day strike in it, eventually had playoffs and a World Series, and the season ended, the Dodgers beat the Yankees in the World Series, then you go into the offseason. Then you have your hot stove league. You have free agent signings and trades and wait till next year and can my team defend and how can we improve, and you sell your season tickets and you make your plans. Here, you don't even know if they're coming to spring training. You don't even know if there's going to be an opening day. And I think the feeling that surrounds this baseball strike is different than those of the past. In the past, people were annoyed and even angered, but they still were hopeful. Now I sense that people have been alienated. I don't say that it's permanent, but I say it'll be longer lasting for many people than it has been in the past.
So you don't believe that as soon as they get it back together, for all those people who say this is different, that as soon as they get the game started again, all those fans will have that long and traditional appetite for the game and come back through?
Especially if it goes well into next season, because then that will render next season invalid competitively, and it won't feel right emotionally. Suppose it goes into May or June. To me, the only thing that makes sense, and I say this only half tongue-in-cheek, let them fight it out, thrash it out, and then start again next August 12th and pick it up with Matt Williams at 43 homers, Tony Gwynn at 394, and Bagwell and Frank Thomas pursuing triple crowns, and everybody still in the same place in the standings, and conclude the season and make it a combined 94-95.
And it's not going to happen, and what you're going to have is a season that's an asterisk.
It'll
say Ken Griffey Jr. had, 30-some home runs, Matt Williams had 43, and Maddox had an ERA of 1.22, and
whatever we can
say about this season so far.
Right.
It'll be an asterisk.
Right. The individual performances will stand, but there will be no
But they'll be incomplete.
Right. Yeah. Right. And it won't be because of an earthquake or a world war or some force of nature. It will be because of the force of greed and intransigence, and people understand that. They understand the difference between something external that you can't control, that's unfortunate, and something that the parties themselves created. Now, leaving aside who is primarily to blame, I think the average person says, look, they got a couple of billion dollars in this industry. They've had at least 2 years to know that this was coming. They can't figure out how to divide the spoils here, and both parties don't have enough concern for the future of the institution to compromise here, and nobody has any creative ideas. Come on.
Don't leave aside the things that you mentioned, greed and intransigence. On the part of whom?
Well, it's interesting. Before you can say that the players are greedy, you have to keep in mind that many of them, especially the highest salaried players, are giving up a ton of money, money they can never get back. This strike can't mean anything to the Oral Hershisers and the Ken Griffey Juniors and the Kirby Pucketts of the world. They've got theirs. They can only lose money by staying out. Any benefit derived from this can only come to their successors. They're well into the primes of their careers. They have long-term deals. Their earning power is set. I think people overlook that. The players are taking a hit in that regard. Their leader, Don Fehr, has not received salary since the work stoppage began. But I think that the Players Association, for all their great gains, for all of the intellect and integrity shown by their leaders through the years, can at times be too doctrinaire. They sometimes sound like they're storming the Bastille or something.
There ought to be
wiggle room
here. So how should they have changed? Where was the wiggle room that they should have accepted and articulated?
Well, I think the idea of a salary cap is not automatically, although they position themselves to reject it, I don't think it's automatically a horrible thing. People point to the inadequacies of the cap in the NBA or the NFL. Devise a better one and set a number.
But I think they would probably say they tried to, and that was what this sort of keeping the salary cap and this taxation mm-hmm. on people who went over a certain level and distributing that revenue
yeah.
with the other players, that was their attempt.
That was a small concession on their part. These parties don't trust each other, and neither one wants to make much of a step this time around in the other's direction. I've always felt, though, that the owners could do quite nicely without a salary cap if they bargain to eliminate salary arbitration, which has nothing to do with a free market wherein a salary is imposed upon the owner, and if they shared their own revenues in a more enlightened way and then simply enforced reasonable budgets.
You, in fact, believe that the issues that divide them are not as important as the attitude they have about each other that divides
right.
them. Mistrust is a greater factor here
I
than salary so. Cap or salary arbitration.
Yeah, because if that history, that badly scarred history, didn't exist, creative minds would sit down and they would come up with some kind of mechanism. It wouldn't have to be a salary cap. They would discuss their differences and their very real and significant common interests, and they'd come up with something.
Have
they've had years to do it.
Have both sides acted in good faith?
Well, the players would tell you that the owners have not. The players would tell you they tend to be historically suspicious of the owners. They would tell you that the owners never really intended to come off the salary cap because they had the legal right to impose their last offer in the off-season if they declare an impasse in the bargaining, and so that was their intention. And many people connected with the union think that it was their intention to break the union and see if the players crack if they take this into next season.
And what do you think?
Well, I think if that was their intention, and if the owners eventually wind up with some concessions because the players have to compromise principle a little bit in the interest of a realistic agreement before some of the cracks begin to show, if in fact, theoretically, there are cracks in the players' unity next year, at this point, for the owners, it'll be a Pyrrhic victory. I said this yesterday to somebody. They'll be like the guy who burned down his house to chase out a rat, and I hope they enjoy celebrating in the ashes, because the damage already done in tangible terms, the hundreds of millions of dollars lost, the possibility
they're
to
putting
capitalize.
They're putting the figure at like $400 million for the owners and 350
yeah.
plus for the players.
And the possibility to capitalize on what could have been a season of great individual achievements, and by luck they could have had the Yankees and Dodgers, or Yankees and Braves, or the Cleveland Indians could have been the darlings of the country, could have been in the World Series.
So baseball this year had a great opportunity to excite the populace and maybe
right.
generate new fans.
Yeah, and they threw it away. And now they have alienated existing fans, and certainly they're not going to attract any new fans through this. And I don't think this ends when they come back. I think that there's going to be a negative inertia to this.
When you look, I want somehow to say, who could have made a difference? I mean, why wasn't that person, that operative idea, there?
The owners decided that a commissioner is always in the position of thinking that he is the czar of baseball, thinking that he has to act in a statesmanlike fashion. And that usually means splitting the difference between the parties, trying to mediate disputes, being susceptible to the pleas of the media and the fans when these work stoppages drag on, and boom, let's try and work something out. They thought that would undercut their interest. They thought Faye Vincent was, among other things that annoyed them about Faye, getting too chummy with the players. So out went Faye Vincent. And obviously,
he forgot who paid his salary, they said.
They said, right. And obviously, they have made no serious effort to replace him because they didn't want a commissioner in place. They wanted one of their fellow owners, Bud Selig, a small market owner at that, acting as their commissioner because they didn't want anybody who wouldn't be on the same page as they were. If they had thought differently about it, I believe what they really needed, going back at least a couple of years and maybe longer, was they needed a commissioner or a group of people unstained by all the past tribulation between the owners and players, a person with a reputation for impartiality who would have been able to take the plea to the players, who would have been able to go to the players and say, look, we're not at the 11th hour yet. We've got a couple of years before this is going to come up. This is the state of baseball. Here are our common interests. Here are our opportunities not only to share existing revenue, but to create an atmosphere in which greater and greater revenue can come to both of us. Let's noodle this around. Let's talk about some ideas. If we're going to strike a new television deal, let's bring you guys in here. If we're going to talk about things that affect the game, let's talk about them. If not making you full-fledged partners, let's get your input. Instead, the players were kept at arm's length. There was a suspicion that the owners girded for war. Whether that was true or not, that was how the players felt.
Because the operative idea was that the owners had lost out in every other
right.
opportunity when it came, push came to shove.
Yeah, the players believe that the owners are always trying in some way to win back in this latest hand
right.
all of their previous losses. Now, I think that while there's a lot of truth to that over time, the owners are now in a position where they have many legitimate points, but they can't get the players to listen. And as always, they went about it the wrong way. If they had spent a couple of years truly trying to engage them, making their case, and showing them the benefit of going about this as something like partners, one of two things could have happened. A, it could have been successful. Or B, they could have made their case to the press and the public, look, we've tried this for a couple of years, and now here's fair warning. Months and months, or next season, down the road, we're heading for a collision here, and then there could be a work stoppage, and then we could lose a season. But it didn't have to play itself out this way.
Here's what I don't understand. Clearly, some of the small town teams, small market teams mm-hmm. is what I was looking for. Some of those places are hurting.
Yep.
We don't know whether it's 19. It's not 19, clearly, what the owner said for a while. It may
right.
be 12. It may be 13.
See, that hurt them, though.
Because
they made 28 of losing money,
yeah.
and only 5 years ago they were found guilty three consecutive seasons by an arbitrator of colluding to hold down salaries. They got a bad history here.
Okay, so there was reason to suspect them, and therefore the mistrust was
right.
had legitimacy. My question is, why couldn't they, if they are hurting, if they wanted cost certainty, what prevented them from opening up the books and making their case to the American people and say, we need some kind of cost control because this is the status of our game. Look at this team, look at this team,
yeah.
look at this team. Why wouldn't they do that?
Well, they did have a joint study committee.
Yeah, but they didn't release the information. And they even swore Don Fear to secrecy. As he sort of
right, and I think they should have been more open about this. They have done
they didn't
a
make their case.
They have done a terrible job making their case to the press and the public, at least that portion of the press and the public that wants to be informed. I think, however, that what they say has some resonance with the average baseball fan. You know, the average baseball fan still sides more with the owners than with the players on this, because he or she says, wait a minute, you know what? I don't care, salary cap, schmallery cap, I don't care about arbitration, I don't care about any of this. These guys are making millions of dollars.
Right.
Some of them are mediocre ball players. How much money do you need to play a game? This is their understandable emotional reaction. So despite all of their missteps, the owners can still tap into a certain reservoir. I don't think it's as large as it used to be, but a certain reservoir of sympathy for their position. Even if the fan doesn't think the owner is that smart or that honorable, he thinks a lot of the players are greedy.
Is part of Bob Costas, who loves baseball, who, in making a determination as to which network he wanted to be employed by, used as the first criteria who would have baseball, a well-known lover of
another
baseball.
Another shrewd move on
by
my
Costas.
Part for the second time in a row.
Is part of you even, at this point, saying, I've had it with this.
Yep,
too much.
Yep. I believe that I understand the issues involved. I've made it my business to be informed about it. I can sit here and discuss the merits
but
of each position.
No, but almost.
Yeah, but after a while, you just say, come on. How tough can it be? You're all among the luckiest people in the world. Let's get this together and play some baseball. And I can tell you this very honestly. I believe that whatever decline there has been in the overall state of baseball, in the overall feeling that you can get from the game, whatever decline there has been in my lifetime of being aware of baseball, more than half of it has happened in the last 5 years. Just so many wrong-headed things, their dealings with television, the way they killed the game of the week, the way so many games are going off free TV, the latest work stoppage, the ongoing acrimony, the inane way that they realigned and restructured the playoffs. And as I told you before, it's not just a traditionalist lament. They could have realigned and restructured in a way that preserved competitive integrity and the dramatic essence of the pennant races, and they did a monumentally stupid thing, and no one bothered to think it through, and now this latest bit of business. And I've thought about this in the last couple of weeks, and I still like baseball, and I'll always like baseball, but if I didn't have an 8-year-old son who loves the game as much or more than I did when I was his age, if I didn't have that 8-year-old son, I think my own interest in baseball would be less than half what it once was. I really do.
Does it pain you to say that?
No.
You know
it
what?
Doesn't.
It's just a statement of fact.
Yeah, yeah. I don't know who's to blame.
Done to this sport.
Right.
You know, you've lost me.
They haven't lost me. Well, I still enjoy broadcasting baseball games, and the craft of it is interesting to me. And I think there's enough worthwhile in the game itself that if someone with vision or some group of people with vision got these parties together and made some right decisions, the game could rebound. But the way it stands now, it is not as appealing. You can't make your way through all the crap to embrace as readily what there is to be enjoyed about the game.
It's almost, I don't want to put words in your mouth, it's almost like you, Bob Costas, is saying, I've just had it, you know, enough of this. Your ineptitude and what you have done to this game is so much that I'm not even angry. You just deserve your fate and therefore.
You know, people stop me, and I'm sure they stop Al Michaels and Jack Buck and Vin Scully and Sean McDonough and everyone else who's associated with broadcasting baseball, John Miller in Baltimore, whomever else, and they say, boy, you must feel terrible. And I'm not so sure how those people feel. But personally, I don't think it's any big tragedy. I expected it. I've come to accept it. The stupidity and wrongheadedness that surrounds what once was a great institution, it's deflating.
I want to turn to Ken Burns' documentary, too, a 9-part series on public television. But before I do that, despite all of that, what it takes is somebody, one person somewhere, with some force and some vision.
Oh, I don't know that there's anyone that can come in on a white steed like Kennesaw Mountain Landis
right.
did under very
after the scandal.
Different circumstances. But I do believe that baseball needs someone of stature, intellect, vision, and some guts who comes from outside the present
morass. Someone like Bart Giamatti,
well, people had high hopes for Bart Giamatti. as beloved as he was, the Players Association had problems with him because they felt that in his role as National League president, he gave at least tacit approval to collusion in the mid to late 1980s. But I think you need someone who comes from outside the present process.
George Mitchell?
Maybe. But
he's not going to be interested now.
I don't know. I wonder about George Mitchell's stance in terms of rolling back baseball's antitrust exemption. Howard Metzenbaum had proposed a bill where it would have been rolled back only as it applied to labor matters. They would have kept it in terms of being able to control franchise relocations, and it would have given the players the option, which players in every other sport have, which is short of a strike, to take the owners to court if they feel they have bargained in bad faith. If baseball did not have that full blanket antitrust exemption, it's very possible that these negotiations would have gone somewhere. That doesn't mean that the owners would have come over to the players' side, but they might have been less inclined to hold fast to one position.
So you think that baseball, the future of baseball would have been best served if they did not have that antitrust exemption. Joe Biden on this program, the chairman of the Judiciary Committee, and it comes before his committee, said earlier to me this weekend in Wilmington, Delaware, you know, that he's going to look into it. Now, what that means, I don't know, but
well,
there clearly
I think
will be more of a move now beyond Howard Metzenbaum to do something.
The House is conducting additional hearings next week. I think Senator Metzenbaum tried to reintroduce it yesterday, and it was shot down. It can't get back into committee because you need unanimous approval, at least this time around.
Okay. Let me take a look at this. Ken Burns series. It comes at an interesting time. No baseball, so we now have an 18-and-a-half-hour series by Ken Burns, who certainly, in terms of people who had not seen this kind of presentation, created a huge splash with a brilliant series on Civil War. You are involved in this. You talk about how it connected you to your father. What do you think about this?
Well, I've seen virtually all of it. And I have to say this up front. Ken Burns is a very good friend of mine. It's an honor, I think, for everyone who's involved, to whatever extent, in this movie, to have been asked and to be involved in something of this quality. And I think that there are moments, not just moments, there are huge segments of this film that are absolutely brilliant and moving. There's an element of journalism and real history here. The research is tremendous. You walk away constantly saying, even someone who's pretty knowledgeable about the game, I didn't know that. Well, that's an interesting twist
and
on
you
things.
Understand the personalities and the forces that have both hammered the game and as well as lifted the game.
There are some masterpieces of film biography here, the sketches of the great players and people who have influenced the game. But I also understand that Ken runs a risk with this. Its length sets the bar very high in the mind of a critic. Gee, 18 and a half, 19 hours? The Civil War was only 11 and a half. This better be at least as good. Well, pretty tough to reach that standard 100% of the time.
He suffers probably by comparison because the Civil War was such a significant event in our time.
Well, I think...
And his film was equally brilliant.
And I say this with great respect. I think that the premise that was at the heart of the Civil War was obvious and true 100% of the time, that he brought to it an unbelievable mountain of research and great talent and skill and insight. But obviously, this was the pivot point in our nation's history, and everything, all the big moments, all the small moments, affected by that. Does baseball mirror American society and bigger issues frequently?
Race and things like race, labor management, a lot of
But not all the time. So it's difficult to sustain that amount of import throughout.
All right, take a look at this. This is just a clip. This premieres Sunday, September 18th at 8 p.m. on PBS, 9-part series. Here is a clip from Ken Burns' baseball.
Quite a touching sight. Everyone standing at Fenway Park as Ted Williams hit probably for the last time in a Boston uniform in this ballpark. There's a drive to deep right center. This may be gone. Brad way back there watching. Home run! Ted Williams!
Right-hander winds and fires. Yastrzemski lines a base hit into center field. He dares around second. He will score. The 1-0 delivery to Fisk. He swings, long drive, left field. If it stays fair, it's gone. Home run! The Red Sox win! And the Sox series is tied 3 games apiece.
First thing about it, and this seems so obvious that maybe we overlook it, baseball is a beautiful thing. It's more beautiful in an old park that's asymmetrical and quirky. But even, and I hate to say this because it might encourage them, but even in a dome with artificial turf, it's beautiful. The way the field fans out, the choreography of the sport, the pace and rhythm of it, the fact that that pace and rhythm allows for conversation and reflection and opinion and comparison.
This is a wonderful film, and Ken is taking an occasional hit because there are some people who have grown weary of the intellectualizing of baseball. And it's true that there are some people that are reaching for a metaphor for every ground ball to second and rhapsodizing about every wild pitch to the backstop. But those who say, ah, it's just a game, they don't get it. Baseball is, first and foremost, a game. But it definitely has a capacity to move people in a way that other sports generally do not. And it definitely has a texture to it that other sports do not. And generally, it deserves the appreciations that you hear people express throughout his film.
And it has introduced us to people like Jackie Robinson, whose impact on American life went beyond the diamond.
Just as foolish, it is just as foolish to say it is only a game as it is foolish to say that it represents every lofty ideal of America or every great theme of civilization. It does. It neither extreme is true.
What I like about the series is that it gives you an insight about the people who've shaped it over the long history. There is one time, one opportunity to get some sense of who Ty Cobb really was, and who Christy Mathewson really was, and who Babe Ruth really was, and who Ted Williams really is. All of that, both those that are living and those that are dead, who have shaped this game.
Yeah, he fills them in and humanizes them in a way that is both journalistic and very human simultaneously.
My friend, thank you very much for coming on A Long Day.
Thank you. I'm fading now.
Bob Costas from NBC News. We'll be right back. Stay with us.
I was born in a harem in 1940 in Fez, Morocco. So began scholar Fatima Mernissi's dreams of Trespass, Tales of a Harem Girlhood. She is a feminist in the Muslim world. She's a researcher at the University of Mohammed in Morocco. She is the author of a number of books, including Islam and Democracy, Fear of the Modern World, The Veil and the Male Elite, A Feminist Interpretation of Women's Rights in Islam. Also, Beyond the Veil, The Forgotten Queen of Islam, and Doing Daily Battle. I am pleased to have you here. Dreams of a Trespass, Tales of a Harem Girlhood is not about a harem as we might at first blush think it is. It is much more about relationships within a community. Tell me about it.
Yes. I discovered when I wrote this book that the Westerners have a different harem from mine. Mine is about an extended family, and it was growing up in a house with 30 people, aunts, relatives, and so on. But the Westerners, for them, the harem is a sexual space.
The notion of a man and many women.
Voila. And there it was just family, mine, my father and my mother, and then my uncle and his wife and children.
Is this autobiographical for you?
It's
a series of sketches of relationships with your aunt and your grandmother and others.
It starts autobiographical, but the personages are fiction. Aunt Habiba is fiction, Shama is fiction, because I wanted to create the atmosphere. And of course, it's much easier to do it with few personages than having the 30 people. This is my first semi-fiction.
Yes.
And I'm not Tolstoy, so I couldn't deal with a lot of people, so I created.
Can you do things here? Can you say things about women that you couldn't in your more scholarly work?
Yes. I wanted to, in my scholarly work, I was always defending and asking and begging for the rights for us.
Yeah. The role of women in a Muslim world.
In Muslim world, in the other university books. But in this one, I wanted to talk about powerlessness. and that really women are about making strength out of powerlessness. And that I couldn't do in the other books.
You're saying that the women are about making strength out of powerlessness.
Yes.
How do you mean?
Well, I think a lot about my childhood. I escaped to this harem, of course. Yes. And I was thinking, really, what did they give me, which gives me strength, myself? And I discovered that it was about talking all the time about powerlessness, but the message was, don't accept to lead a humiliated life. Mm-hmm. And I think that is what strength is about. It's to desire strongly to have a graceful life. Mm-hmm. I think
a lot of these stories, though, are about the daily chores of a woman's life.
But even those,
inside,
you know,
the wall.
Yes. But even those were done with some kind of grace, and also there was a lot of imagination and storytelling inside these walls. And that also struck me, that you could do, out of prison, you could create theater. And that stayed
with me. Out of prison, so are you characterizing their lot, their life, as prison?
Yes.
Because they cannot escape beyond the wall.
Yes.
Because they have no freedom.
Yes.
Is that the life of a woman in today's, in your judgment, as a scholar and as a woman of the Middle East, of Muslim women, a prison?
No. There is a lot of conservative people in my part of the world who would like to make my life a prison, but...
Make your life a prison?
Yes, who dream about having women behind walls, still.
Right.
But that is their fantasy. And the reality is that women have gotten out of these harems. And we are contributing. There is one third of women, of the doctors in the Arab world are women. One third of lawyers are women. We are paying taxes, we are good citizens, and we want to have our rights.
What rights don't you have? Give us a picture.
What rights?
Of those who have, you know, all of these professional achievements. What restrictions are there?
No, in the Arab world, in the professional world, there is no, in my university, they don't discriminate against me. Because the Arabs always liked women with brains.
Yes.
That doesn't disturb them. But women getting into politics, women taking part in the lawmaking, that is something which is really a complete change of the mentality.
You've written about Benazir Bhutto.
Yes. For example, they told when Benazir Bhutto took power, they said, in all the press, Arab press, there is no women who ruled the Arab or Muslim world before. It took me 6 months, and with the help of some historians, to find out 16 women ruled the Muslim world as head of state. Madame Bhutto was number 17.
Who were some of them that were we might recognize? Any?
I don't know. Even for me, it was discovery.
Yeah.
What is interesting to know is that a big number were Asian, from Asia, and also many Turkish women, some Iranian women, very, very few Arab women.
How much progress has been made? You proudly call yourself a feminist.
Oh, yes.
How much progress has been made, say, in the last 10 years in your world?
You see, the Arabs have realized now, like, I am not from an oil country. Maybe we should make a big this division. In oil countries...
United Arab Emirates and Kuwait and Saudi Arabia. And
because they are not making... they are not a normal economy. But we have to, we produce goods with our work, so there is a huge women's proletariat. in North Africa, for example. And we are very important for the relationship with Europe because the agricultural industry and textile, it's 60% women. Also, the country came in the last 10 years to realize that women are an asset. And one can say that the change, like in the King of Morocco, has changed towards women. There is now women in the parliament, and all these changes are in the last 10 years. There is nominations of women in high posts.
And the king is supportive of these changes?
Oh, yes. And he at the same time, he is now strongly for tolerant Islam. So, as a feminist, I am not a nobody. I am millions of people, you know, I am the future. But somehow we don't make the news like conservative men who are using violence, for example. They get more attention. But the Arab world and the Muslim world is not only those people. It's also us women who want to make for peaceful and competitive and competition. It's also women competing.
What do you think of the direction and attitude toward feminism in America in the 1990s?
For me, Madame Clinton, for example, Hillary Clinton is this new American feminism, which is balanced.
A new American woman.
New American woman.
She has been working all of her adult life. She was a lawyer, graduated with the same academic.
She's fighting for the health, for health. This is, for us, it's a fantastic model.
So she looks to the rest of the world. She is, in fact, a role model for a contemporary woman.
Oh, definitely, yes.
Yeah. More popular, perhaps, than her husband?
No, the couple, I like the idea of the couple, and I think that's very attractive to the Arab world, who are so worried about the family than this
Can
couple.
You imagine that happening in a country that you know in the Arab world?
Probably more in, of all the countries, maybe. No, I don't dare to.
Oh, no, go ahead.
This is political.
Yeah,
yeah, I am so worried to say a blunder.
Yeah.
But I could imagine it in in Egypt.
In Egypt,
it
right.
Could happen.
But in Israel, you've had a woman as prime minister.
Madame Golda Meir.
Yeah.
Ah, oui, bien sûr.
Yeah.
Oui.
What are the issues? I mean,
she was very powerful in the Arab world.
Yes,
powerful
she was,
model of
right.
womanhood.
She was there at the time of the war.
Yes.
Matriarch. A matriarchal.
Yes, she was like Madame Indira Gandhi, more of a war goddess.
A war goddess. And is that good? I mean, do you think that's not good?
No.
So that's not the image that you want?
I prefer Madame Clinton, who is a happy couple of two people who are strong, both of them.
Rather than a war goddess.
Yes.
Yeah.
Which one do you like?
Between?
The,
among?
The war goddess or Madame Hillary Clinton?
Well, I mean, it would be on. I admired Golda Meir and Indira Gandhi both for being strong leaders. I disagreed with some of their respective policies, and I have much admiration for Mrs. Clinton because of. Because she does represent a contemporary woman. I also have enormous respect for those who elect not to do the path that she does, those who feel strongly about working inside the home and playing a different role than viewing them with equal respect. But she certainly represents, I think, a role model for millions of young American women she's a visible model of someone who has an exciting life outside of the home and an interesting, exciting life inside the home and as a mother and a wife and at the same time a highly respected, intelligent, professional person. So, Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not either or for me. I mean, it seems to me, when you look at the role that Golda Meir played in the history of Israel, I mean, you have to have enormous sense of respect for her as a founder and as a shaper of her nation's destiny, regardless of gender. It's just that's the historical place she played, as did Indira Gandhi.
Yeah, and because she
probably much stronger than a lot of men.
Oh yes, definitely. In the Middle East, she was very stronger than most of leaders.
Yes. Where do you go from here? I mean, what do you hope to accomplish? Because your life work really has been about women and their place in society. In the world of Islam.
Yes. What I would like is to have, for example, the aid to Third World tied to women's rights. If this can happen, that is that the countries will not receive the aid unless they, for example, they put a lot of money in education of women so that we don't have illiteracy.
Right.
In the Muslim world, we are still, there is 60-70% of women illiterate. This is disgrace. It shouldn't be there in the next 5 years.
Before international organizations like the World Bank or the UN or anyone else makes grants to underdeveloped countries, you would like to see them make those grants conditioned on human rights and women's rights and children's rights?
Yeah, they are not giving us grants because we are paying the
right,
debt,
sure,
a lot of money. So it's not charity, but if they are giving, they should tie whatever they are giving to the women's rights, and it will go very fast because the money is very important.
And to be spent on issues like illiteracy.
Yes.
Dreams of Trespass, Tales of a Harem Girlhood, Fatima Mernissi. Thank you very much.
Merci beaucoup. Thank you.
We'll be right back. Stay with us.
If all diseases were eliminated, how long would we live? And why do women live longer than men? Here to answer these questions and more is a gerontologist, Leonard Hayflick. He's a cell biologist and he is professor of anatomy at the University of California in San Francisco. His book, How and Why We Age, brings forth questions about the phenomenon of aging and mortality, and I'm pleased to have him here. Welcome.
Thank you.
Why do we age? I mean, is it just that the vital organs go through a kind of deterioration until they can no longer function and that's when we die?
No, that's indeed what happens. However, it's interesting to point out that humans and the animals that we choose to protect, like our zoo animals and pets, are the only animals that do age under present arrangements. For example, feral or wild animals have very little evidence of aging. As soon as they reach the peak of sexual maturation and raising their offspring to maturity, and then begin to go downhill, as it were, they get eaten by a predator or
So that's a selection process. That's a natural selection process.
And that's exactly
takes place
what
in the wild.
Exactly, and that's exactly what has happened to humans. We have been selected by natural selection to live long enough to do just that, reach sexual maturation, raise children to maturity. After that, as far as the survival of the species is concerned, it's unimportant that people live beyond the age of 30, let's say.
Is all that changing because of the fast forward of modern medicine?
Exactly. We have learned to deal with the major causes of death in our youth to the extent that many more people are living longer now than they ever have, specifically infectious diseases, which are no longer really a serious problem for the youth in developed countries, at least.
Yeah. How significant is mental health to longevity?
We don't really have any direct evidence that mental health plays a role in
the absence of stress, a positive quality of life.
Yes, this is often invoked as a reason for some individual's longevity, but we really have no direct evidence of the role that it plays. What we can say, however, is that it certainly plays a role, of course, in one's own self-awareness and one's own personal health.
Yeah, but you do show that certain kinds of professions, in certain professions, people live longer. corporate executives live longer because they have access to better health care, correct?
Precisely.
Now, what about conductors? There is at least the conventional wisdom is that conductors live longer.
Well, in fact, they do live longer than the general population, and they also have the same kind of access to good medical care that a corporate executive might have, in addition to which they pay attention more to their health status, respond to any signs of ill health in the way that a corporate executive might have. Now, it is biased to claim that only orchestra conductors and CEOs have greater longevity. There are many categories of other people who can avail themselves of the same resources.
Yeah. What do you do? I mean, it seems to me, and everybody I've ever talked to, I mean, you're a cell biologist, and you understand, you know, how cells function, and I assume that how cells function is at the core of this.
Yes? Absolutely. Absolutely.
How so?
Well, we at one time didn't think as seriously as we do now about the role of individual cells in aging for the following important reason. Up until about 1960 or 61, it was believed that when you take the cells of humans and animals and put them into culture, laboratory culture vessels, that they will divide and flourish indefinitely. In other words, that they were immortal. This dogma was believed for about 60 years. A colleague of mine, Dr. Paul Moorhead, and I discovered in 1960 that this, in fact, was untrue, that when normal human and animal cells were put into culture, they had a limited capacity to divide and function. The reason that was important is that if you imagine that the dogma that cells were immortal was, in fact, true, then aging could have nothing to do with events that occur inside of cells, because once you remove them from an animal or a human, grew them in culture, showed that they were immortal, clearly aging would have nothing to do with events inside of cells. It must have to do with events outside of cells. Well, we overturned that dogma and argued that the phenomenon of the limited lifetime of cultured normal human cells was an expression of the aging phenomenon. And indeed, in the subsequent 30 or 35 years, many people who have entered this field have found literally a catalog of losses and gains and other things that don't change in normal human cells as they age in culture. So we have a kind of microcosm in a cell of age changes that we see in a whole human.
If you could wipe out heart disease, people would live 15 years longer.
Approximately.
And if you could wipe out cancer,
about 2 years.
Now, well, I explain that to me.
Well, it's very easy to make those determinations statistically by taking a large number of death certificates and removing those that that describe the cause of death attributable to cancer, and then assume that these individuals will die of the remaining causes. And when you do that kind of analysis, you come up with a gain in life expectation of about 2 years for cancer. You come up, as you indicated, with about 15 years for cardiovascular disease and stroke. Mm.
Is there any cell therapy that accentuates youth?
It depends.
Well, you know what I'm talking about. For a long time,
definition of youth.
Well, there have been people who've reached middle age in 50s and 60s. You know, who've been off in pursuit of sheep cell therapy, who've been off in pursuit of all kinds of rejuvenation of their cellular composition.
We have no evidence that this works. In fact, it's not used in this country. It's essentially illegal.
FDA prevents it, doesn't it?
Oh, yes. Right. It's not a licensed
But wealthy people go to Europe and have it done?
Yes, without any evidence of efficacy whatsoever, and with a great deal of risk involved, I might say.
Yeah. What's the downside? What's the risk?
The downside is that it could trigger a violent immunological reaction, conceivably causing death.
How far are we away? And we all read the papers every day, and there's much more reporting of medical news. I mean, the New York Times does an enormous amount of medical coverage. How far are we from, in a sense, organ replacement, so that we all will live much longer? If, in fact, there's a history of diabetes, then you can, you know, change the pancreas, I guess. Or what organ is it secretes insulin?
Yes, the
pancreas.
The islets. Islet cells.
How far are we away from that?
Well,
because of the rejection therapy and all that. So.
Yes, but we do have medical procedures for reducing or eliminating the immunological response to foreign tissue transplants.
I'm asking that also. I'm asking the whole question of is because of what's going on in terms of genetic changes.
Well, let's assume
changing the genes that cause the disorder.
Let's assume that one can replace virtually all vital organs or all vital organs.
Is that
there's
a good
one
idea?
Organ. Well, I don't think so.
Why there's not?
There's one organ that I don't think anyone would want to change, and that is your brain, simply because that represents you. It's your self-identity. It's your memory of past experiences. If indeed it could be done, and I don't think there is a scientist who believes it can be done, at least within our lifetime or the lifetime of our children, the identity of that individual would be lost. So that the reason for making such a transplant, if it were possible, fails.
What's the most exciting area of the research today for you in the problem and the issue of aging?
Well, there are really two that come to mind immediately. One of them has nothing to do with laboratory research, strangely enough, and that is the change that's taken place in the attitudes of people in this country specifically, that 10 or 15 years ago had us believing that when you grow old, your cognitive abilities fail and you become senile. What has happened in the past 10 or 15 years is that people's beliefs about senility have changed dramatically. Thankfully, very few people now believe, and rightly so, that everyone is destined to reach senility when they grow old. That's pure hokum.
But there is a diminution in the capacity, is it not?
Well, there's a subtle diminution. The old saw goes that there are three early signs of old age. The first is the loss of short-term memory, and I don't remember the other two.
Yes.
However, there are other known changes. For example, reaction time increases. That is when you're stimulated or when you touch something that's hot. The
older you are, the faster you take your hand off?
You don't take your hand away fast enough so that you incur a greater degree of burn as you get older. Yeah. And of course, there are other changes in respect to one's ability to see and to hear most frequencies. But these are not lethal changes. Right. These are annoyances, certainly, but they're for the most part not lethal.
What about drugs?
In
respect to increasing longevity, and in respect to...
Well, we don't... I should make a blanket statement, and that is that we know of no method that will interfere or perturb the fundamental aging processes as distinguished from disease, and that's a very critical distinction, the one that must be made between diseases and aging. Diseases don't happen to everyone, regardless of the disease you might invoke. But aging, if you're lucky enough, is experienced by everyone. Mm-hmm. In addition to which, there are certain characteristics of aging that I don't think anyone would characterize as disease. For example, the graying of the hair, mm-hmm. the wrinkling of the skin, changes in one's ability to exercise or perform in athletics. Those are not life-threatening. They're not characterized as disease. Now, it's important then to make this critical distinction. The resolution of diseases, however, will only add, I say only because if people are interested in orders of magnitude of increase in their longevity, then all we can do at the moment is perturb the diseases that are associated with aging, that which the underlying aging process increases the vulnerability to diseases. In fact, one could argue that no one over the age of 65, for example, has ever died from what's written on their death certificate. What they have died from is a greater vulnerability due to the normal aging process to what was written on the death certificate, even to the extent of an accident where you could have conceivably reacted more slowly, jumped less quickly, or didn't see coming early enough.
How and Why We Age, Leonard Hayflick, PhD, a book that explores the whole notion of longevity in America. Hugh Downs actually mentioned Dr. Hayflick to me, has said in his book, he set forth a history of aging theory, sorted out and resolved fragmentary and conflicting ideas about why organisms age and die, and has dispatched several aging myths, all with certain style and clarity. I thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us this evening. We look forward to seeing you again next time. See you then.
Hot town, summer in the city. Back of my neck getting dirt and gritty. Bend down, isn't it a pity? Doesn't seem to be a shadow in the city. All around, people looking half dead. Walking on the sidewalk harder than a match, yeah. But at night, it's a different world. Go out and find a girl. Come on, come on, dance all night. Despite the heat, it'll be all right. Don't you know it's a pity the days can't be like the nights in the summer. In the city, in the summer.
It was the tightest race in American League history, with Boston, Detroit, Minnesota, and Chicago all in contention. In the Red Sox final 12 games, Yastrzemski batted .523 with 23 hits, 5 home runs, and 16 RBIs.
There are some people who think that Carl Yastrzemski's last 2 weeks of the 1967 Impossible Dream season were the best 2 weeks that any baseball player ever had.
Major funding for Charlie Rose was provided by DuPont, originator of products and ideas that make a difference in everyday life. DuPont. Better things for better living. And by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. And the annual financial support of viewers like you. Charlie Rose was also made possible by these funders. To order Charlie Rose program transcripts for $5 each and video cassettes for $29.95 each, call 1-800-825-5746 or write to Journal Graphics at the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest. This is PBS.